The following Conscious Consumer Network recording of a live broadcast is available to purchase in high definition at ethymarket.com. Support free and independent media by becoming a CCN pledger. For 10 euros a month, you can have unlimited access to CCN high definition downloads at ethymarket.com. Ethymarket, the ethical marketplace for conscious consumers.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. Be inspired by the voices of visionaries, changemakers, and ordinary, extraordinary people who do what they do all for the love of learning.
This is For the Love of Learning, Voices of the Alternative Education Movement. I'm Lady Liberty, and this is episode number 26. During tonight's show, we'll take a look at the concept of uncareering, mentoring, and entrepreneurship. Classic mentorship is described as a personal developmental relationship in which more experienced or a more knowledgeable person helps to guide a less experienced or less knowledgeable person. Tonight, we'll be looking at these relationships in the context of business, social justice projects, and community. We have a panel of three very diverse approaches, each which challenge the status quo and push the boundaries of the current learning, education, business, work paradigms. In fact, we could call all of these approaches uncareering. I'm going to give a brief introduction of each of our panelists, and then we'll start the conversation. Although these introductions are brief, we have more information about each of our panelists on the show notes page located at consciousconsumernetwork.tv, and look for the show notes page for episode number 26. There you will find more extensive information about each of our panelists' backgrounds and links to their projects and websites. First, I'd like to introduce you to Philippe. Philippe is a professional hippie and a social artist who enjoys playful challenges, oneness, and collaboration. The question he asks himself is, how can we be that transformation that we need in this world? Is discovering and experimenting new spaces and new ways to live together and collaborate. Put him in a self-organized and non-hierarchical processes, and he'll go with the flow. It's about finding the protected space within us and expand our impact and influence by bonding and creating trust and harmony. He feels most motivated in disruptive environments where people take on ownership and make the impossible happen. Our next panelist is Etienne. Etienne is an innovator, social entrepreneur, and change maker. German by blood, Ugandan by heart, he started the NGO Janju to support Ugandan orphans through educational sponsorships in high schools. The first class of his students graduated in 2013, but despite academic achievements, drowned in 83% youth unemployment. Uganda has the world's youngest population of 78% below the age of 30, and Uganda is systematically conditioning its people to seek jobs rather than to create them through a rigid colonialist school system, while creative capacities and social capital wither. Our final panelist tonight is Luke. Luke started his career as a derivatives trader managing S&P 500 futures. In 2011, he became a registered investment advisor. He left the U.S. in September of 2013 in search of a new opportunity, economic freedom, and work that brought meaning back into his life. He's a senior fellow at Exosphere and facilitator of the Hydra Series boot camps. He is the co-founder and front-end developer at Vertico, a software startup. He enjoys studying quantum technologies, ancient history, and grace. So what a great panel, and let's jump right in. So I'm so thrilled that we have this incredible panel here with us tonight, and I know tonight's going to be an incredible, fascinating conversation. But what I do want to do is go to each of our panelists first and ask you to share a little bit about your background, and also if you can share a little bit about the projects that you're working on that we're going to speak about tonight. So Etienne, I'm going to hand the floor over to you.
Yeah, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to be part of this tonight. I'm Etienne. I'm originally from Germany, but since almost 9 years, I've been on and off in Uganda and live here now since 2 years permanently. And my journey with Uganda started actually in an orphanage where kids grew up until the age of like 12, and they got supported in primary school. But then when they finished primary school, they were off to themselves because they couldn't, the orphanage couldn't support them anymore for secondary school. So I asked families and friends from around the world if they wanted to support the kids for secondary sponsorships. And I started an NGO for the sponsorships since 2009. And then in 2013, the first generation of these sponsored kids, they finished their A-levels, their high school. And then was a big question, what do we do now? Because university is really, really expensive compared to the incomes in Uganda. And they couldn't find jobs because the youth unemployment rate in Uganda is really, really high. So it seemed a bit lost to support youth until they finish high school when they cannot do much about their lives after with the education they have received. So we sat together and we decided we need to do something that is more practical. It allows people to create their own jobs and not just seek jobs, because the educational system especially just puts so much knowledge into people that they can't really apply. And especially in Uganda, they're not allowed even sometimes to ask questions or to do anything creative or anything different. So we set up the Social Innovation Academy, which we in short call SINA. And SINA is exactly about the youth empowerment to the point where they can be self-sustainable. So we have created a complete setting and working in a way that we empower the youth through mentoring and through coaching to come up with new ideas. And then we incubate their ideas into projects, and the projects grow slowly by slowly until they can be fully grown social businesses that have the capacity to go out and create jobs for the students from SINA, but also then create jobs for others in Uganda. That's in a nutshell what SINA is. And it's going on really, really well for now.
Wow, it sounds like an amazing program. You found that there was a very definite need, and you fulfilled that need within this community. I wonder, how do you gauge the success of the projects that you're helping to incubate?
Well, basically, it all depends on the students themselves. We don't give them much framework. We're open to support them in anything that they want to do. And then the success depends on many different factors. If students want to work in the agricultural field, it's very different than if you work in technical directions or in social directions. So we are open for any kind of projects. And as long as the project is not harmful to the environment or the society, and preferably goes in the direction of a social business, that is even having a positive impact on a society and environment. But depending on the project, it can be very different, and you have to measure it in very different terms.
Wonderful. And I do want to get into what you mentioned with mentorship a little bit later on in the show, but thank you. That was a beautiful introduction, and I'm looking forward to learning more. Why don't we jump on over to Luke next? And Luke, why don't you go ahead and share with us a little bit about your background and about the projects that you're working on that you want to talk about here on the show tonight?
Thank you, Lainey. My background, I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri, in the Midwestern part of the United States. And I went to college, went to university. I studied business administration with a focus on entrepreneurship. Somehow I got into finance, like a lot of young people looking for jobs, find a finance job and kind of go for it. And, you know, things happen. You know, I liked it a little bit, but I started working 5 years in finance, and I kind of realized that there was something more in life. You know, I didn't really quite feel fulfilled, or that I was really providing much value to anyone other than already very wealthy people. So I kind of wanted to make a change. So I started looking to, you know, continue my career inside of finance. So I started looking to other cities, like other financial centers in the world. So I was looking towards like Hong Kong, Dubai, Singapore, places like this, to continue my career. But then, you know, I met a lot of really cool people along the way, but I didn't really find a position to kind of help me keep going, because I knew I wanted to travel. And I thought that maybe traveling would kind of take care of that feeling of, you know, emptiness and kind of like the non-fulfilled part of life. I thought maybe, you know, if I travel, go to a different culture, meet some new people, it might give me a little bit more fulfillment in life. But nothing happened. So then I started looking towards South America. A lot of people were talking about Chile at the time, a lot of people in the libertarian circle, you know, talking about freedom, economic opportunity, things like this. So I started looking towards Chile, and I found a program called Exosphere. And it's really unique because Exosphere was, you know, a 12-week boot camp at the time, that at the time they were teaching all about entrepreneurship and how to start a company. And that's really what I wanted to do. I didn't think I had the skills in my own repertoire to start my own company, because I thought that, you know, the things that I was learning, you know, I didn't think I had what it took to do that. So I was looking for something led by people that were doing actual entrepreneurship, not just, you know, people in university that had read about it and taking classes. I wanted to learn from people that were actually doing the business. So it's really strange. Whenever you find something online, like whenever you research a topic, it seems to me that there's a bit of a Pareto distribution of about 80 to 20, maybe even 90 to 10 of the large majority. They're not really talking about things that are based on truth or, you know, founded on real world principles. But then sometimes you get lucky and you find these small little minorities that you really connect with what they're talking about. And that's what I found with Exosphere. I really felt that the website that they were talking about, the things that I was reading about these guys, it seemed like they really knew what they were talking about, and they weren't sugarcoating things just to sell their product. On the website, it says, entrepreneurship is not easy. It's going to be one of the most difficult things you've ever done in your life. Talking about there's no quick solutions to life. You're going to have to go through a lot of pain. You're going to have to grow. You're going to have to do a lot of different things in order to reach your goals. But they said, you know, we're going to support you in any way we can. There's other people coming to the program that are in the same place as you are. You're going to bring you guys together in a community and help you achieve those goals, even though it's going to be a lot of hard work. So I really appreciated that. And it seemed to me that those were the guys that I wanted to learn from. So in September of 2013, I left the United States, quit my job, sold my car, pretty much sold out for South America. And some people called me crazy. Some people still call me crazy for still being here. But, you know, it worked out. I went to the program. I met a lot of really fantastic people from all over the world. There was 30 of us, and I think there was 12 countries represented. So people from Europe, people from Asia, all up and down the Americas. And, you know, it was the biggest takeaway for me was that I did have what it took to become an entrepreneur. I just needed to get a new set of information. I needed to meet some new people. I needed to get out of my old context that was the United States. And now I'm continuing to work with Exosphere. I'm actually the main facilitator of the Hydra Series Bootcamp, and that's kind of like the main program that we have. And really, if I could define Exosphere now, because it's changed quite a bit, we call ourselves a learning and problem-solving community. And in that, you know, we can take a lot of different shapes and sizes, but the core is that we bring people together that want to change their life. They either want to become better, they either want to change their career, they want to do something more. And we get them together and we help them ask the right questions. It's not really so much about, you know, finding solutions or answers, because those answers will always change with new information. So really we want to encourage people to take a different look at their life and then help them ask the right questions.
Wonderful. I'm really excited. I can't wait to get into this conversation. This is really shaping up to be an incredible panel. What I love is what's slightly different than what Etienne does is you're working with a different demographic, and I think there's a lot of crossover here. So excited to get into the conversation. Thank you so much for this introduction. And before we get any deeper, let's jump over to Philippe and ask you to share a little bit about your background and the projects that you're currently working on that you want to share and talk about in tonight's show. So the floor is yours, Philippe.
Hi guys, thank you very much for inviting. It's really excited to meet you all. Very excited also to see Etienne after really some time. I'm now 36 years old, was born and raised in Austria. Had a very traditional way of growing up in high school, university. I graduated in business administration, international business, and physical education. This was like a mixture because I felt like it's not everything what we are talking about in business administration in the way how we do the business is really in there. And I was really searching for like also the connectedness with the body, the connectedness with the physical world that we are in. And after a while, after my first job was setting up a skill management program for an international company. I was traveling a lot to Asia at that time, a lot to Brazil, North America, and Europe. But after a while, I was really like, well, that's not really it. We're creating work for other people to work, but what is really the impact that we are creating in what we are doing, and how can we really use our energy to create something that is meaningful and is really like transforming the world that we need. After that, I quit my job, like went skiing for a year, like was really searching for what do I really want to do. And in 2010, I had a couple of dreams. And the first dream was like me writing a concept about social business. And I've never been involved with social business. And then was like, okay, what do I do with that now? I went to some friends who are involved with social business. Then the whole journey started for me. A second dream occurred at the time, and I decided after that to move to Brazil and to spend my time in Brazil. And there a friend asked me, what do you want to really do in your life? And I was like, well, to be honest, I really want to meet all the shiny people and people who are really like believing in a different world, who are really doing something very differently. And I was like very clear, okay, you don't find them in business, you don't find them in, or you find them, but it's really hard to find them. I really wanted to go to the really nice places and meet them in kind of in crowd. And what was very clear for me at that time, okay, then you should better go to schools, because they are really like, they're pure. People are not really like giving him truths that they think it's really what we need. And but schools as well, they are like really like not always the places where those truths are not already there. So I was looking very much on alternative education spaces. I was very much looking for learning spaces that are not following the norm, who are really like kind of outside the system, who are like alternatives. And this was the time when we started a collective, an NGO, which is called Presenci. And it's a very unusual organization, I would say. We don't have any structure. We don't have a fixed team, crew. We are going with the flow, which is coming up, what is needed. We see, we test, we experiment, we learn for ourselves. And we, at the same time, we are raising the consciousness about, okay, what are new solutions? Are there old solutions which are not really in the system yet? That said, I also need to say that I'm not against the system. For me, it's really very much that we came to a point where the system that we created is very much obsolete, or in some ways, in some points, not fulfilling the purpose anymore. And now for me, it's really the moment of not fighting the system, but really creating new alternatives or supporting new alternatives that are really living up to a point where we are connected with each other again. This is what Presentia is doing. Today we might talk about a little bit about the initiatives that we're doing. We came up with a conscious leadership program, which is called Ed on Tour. Everything what we're doing around Presentia is without hierarchy. It's very in a fluid network. It's very self-organized, and this is also something what we have learned in the past. It's really a great experience because it's so outside of the box. It's so outside what we know. It's so outside of what we have been learning in school. It's really like living in a democratic way. What does this mean? We intend to know, but where do we learn it? In school, you're like in a dictatorship. The teacher is telling you what you have to do, and after that, you're free, and then you should really decide for your life what is best for you, what is best for your community, what is best for the world. So this is what we're really experiencing on ours for ourselves very much, with also struggles and very nice, interesting learning experiences. And the second project initiative that we are doing, it's like we came up with the Edo Hack, the 24-hour education hackathon. And this is a very distributed way of bringing people together who really want to change and who really want to create kind of an impact in the local community. Everything is set up by Facebook, is communicated by Facebook. There is, again, no fixed team, not a structure which is really like very clear to many people who are outside of the whole group. And this was a very success, and we have some great learnings over the last 2 years. Now it's 1.5 years that we rerun it. And we're very excited to share, to learn from you, to also understand what you understand among entrepreneurship, social innovation, how things are going in Africa, how things are going in South America and Chile. I'm pretty sure that, for example, that the education revolution or the evolution of education will be started or coming out very strongly from South America. Very happy to be here, and thank you very much for an invitation again.
Yeah, I'm so, again, so thrilled that this panel has been put together, and this is the great work of our producer Nina. She had some great vision for this panel. But one of the things that I've noticed from all three of your introductions is you've already defined the traditional paradigm of success, normally entrepreneurship, equals, it's boiled down to the finest minute factor, which is success, and generally it's financial success. But each one of you have brought up mentorship as part of this paradigm. And for me, that, I mean, I'm not real versed in entrepreneurship, but for me, that sounds to me like it's almost a revolutionary thought. Can anybody talk about the importance of mentorship in not only your programs, but in your conceptual thinking, the paradigm of shifting how we work with each other and how we work for one another? So who would like to take that? Okay, Luke, why don't you jump right in?
Well, for me, whenever I first went to Chile, probably the biggest, most important part of my success was just having a group of people where right when I landed in Chile, I knew 30 people from around the world, just because before the program started, I met these people on Facebook. We generated friendships. And instantly, I was plugged into a group. And because of their networks, I automatically knew other people in Chile because we had a few locals there too. So if I would have gone to Chile, for example, but just by myself saying, okay, I want to go to Chile to learn what it's about, to start a company or whatever it may be, it would have been an immensely more difficult task because it would be starting from zero. And anybody who wants to maybe go to a new country, go to a new place, I highly, highly recommend finding a group of people where you can plug in before you even get there, because otherwise you're going to be starting from scratch. It's really difficult. But one of the things we talk about at Exosphere is self-reliance by Ralph Waldo Emerson. We read this text a lot, and he starts it off and he says, "Man is his own star, and the soul that can render an honest and a perfect man commands all light, all influence, all fate. Nothing for him falls early or too late. Our acts, our angels are, for good or ill, our fatal shadows that walk by us still." And the thing is, if you look at that, like, man is his own star, and he talks about, like, people have to realize success. Yeah, some people, success is purely money, purely power. But if that's what you want in life, that's great. But you really have to ask yourself, you know, what is it do I really want? Do I want money, success? That's fine. But a lot of people are just taking that because society tells them that's what they should want. And the thing is, people that come to Exosphere, especially the Hydra program, it's meant for entrepreneurship. But at the same time, we've had people that wanted to become artists, people that wanted to become musicians, people that wanted to go back to a traditional career. And that's okay. We want to help people find the place in life where they want to be. And, you know, once Exosphere is over, we try to plug people into our network that's around the world and the mentor network, because, you know, we find that during the 8-week program, people are really fired up because you're around all these other people that are really hungry, really trying to learn. But then once everyone leaves, they go back home or wherever it may be, it's kind of like this big brick wall, and people just hit it and they just kind of stop. Like, inertia comes back into their lives because they're like, you know, we talk every day at Exosphere, solve the problems that need to be solved today. And everyone focuses on, okay, what are we going to do today? What are our goals? What are we going to do? But then you go back home and you fall back in that old context. You go back and start having the same conversations with your old friends because you've been changing for 8 weeks. And then you go back home and everyone's like, oh, so yeah, how's the baseball team? How's the basketball team doing? And we try to help the people that leave the program continue this upward trend, because people go through these huge transformations. But like you said, like everybody said here, the key is finding people that kind of have the results that you want, attaching to them and learning from them, and, you know, having a kind of like creative collaboration. And really at Exosphere, that's like all in all education, it should be about personalized learning, where the relationship between the student and the teacher should be characterized by love and like creativeness and, you know, kind of like a mutual collaboration.
Yeah. Thank you, Luke. I think what I heard from you is a little bit that people get stuck a lot in the paradigm of what they're used to, or what their friends are doing around, or what their schools or their networks are doing around. And I think we see a similar challenge here in Uganda, because especially here, people get stuck so much in hierarchical systems, because everywhere from family to school to companies to the government, it's all very, very, very hierarchical. And then they don't come out of the system so easily because they get told every day what they need to do. So they easily fall back as well. When they do something different, they fall easily back into the old system because they have to fight against the structure very, very much. So what we create in SINA, whereby mentoring and as well as coaching are really important roles in the education model, is that we, in coaching, like similar to life coaching, we need to set goals with the students. We need to find out where do they want to go? How do they see themselves? What do they want to leave as a legacy in life, or how do they want to reach that as well? And once students have set a goal, then maybe sometimes it's the first time ever people have asked them this, because a lot of times we get all told by a lot of people, like, you should be doing this, or this is the right way for you. But when you really deeply ask people what they want to do, they have similar ideas that they want to do something that is meaningful, and not so much about money, or not so much about monetary success. So once they have it clear where they want to go in life, then I think the money becomes less important. And money is just a means, but it's not the end. And then we bring in our coach, our mentoring, which is more project related. So in coaching, we don't force or enforce anything on the students. We just ask the right questions. But in mentoring is then more, okay, now we have set the goal. We want to go in this direction. Now we need to set specific steps. How do we get there? And it's by starting a project. It's by starting or coming up with ideas and trying them, prototyping them, seeing how they could be developed. And the mentors then help them really structure their ideas, putting them into a business model canvas and starting to interview potential customers. And the mentors help them really to structure and move forward and incubate the idea and the whole academy, the Social Innovation Academy, and then brings them as well some startup capital. And we try to give incentives as well that the ideas and the projects they're doing are socially and environmentally friendly, so they get a bonus if they're tackling a challenge that actually solves environmental challenge or social challenge, and then they move forward. And even actually our first business that has gone out is exactly doing that. They are tackling a social and environmental challenge, and they came up with a great innovation that is producing a flooring solution out of plastic bags and eggshells. Because plastic bags are flying around everywhere in Uganda, and they're even in the channels of the water sewage systems, and they're blocking and causing floods and problems. And it's environmentally friendly, and also solving this challenge of what do you do with the plastic bags, and how do you use waste sustainable, or how do you even reduce waste, and what are ways you can think outside the box and come up with something. But of course, an idea like this needs constant mentoring and setting up the goal where you want to go, and we believe nothing is impossible. If you have this goal, you'll find a way to get there.
What I like very much, what you're saying is like that you have kind of a community that is supporting you in your faith and what you believe in. We also see mentoring, the process of mentoring very important. The mentor itself can be anybody around you. I think this is also very important that this is not just focusing on one mentor, which is then again creating hierarchy. It's a mentor who knows everything, a mentor who is really like already went this way. But you also need to find your own way. So what I like very much what you said at the end was like asking the right questions. It's not about giving the advice, but it's more about creating clarity for yourself, where you want to go, what you want to do, and how you can really reach it with your talents, with your resources that you have, with the abundance around you. At the same time, I also see that the way we use it, we use a lot of game elements and game mechanics in order to create a transparency in this learning process. We play with the idea of reaching a point and reaching a goal, and maybe then in the goal we realize, or people realize, it's not actually what I intended to be, but maybe it's just a milestone on the way, on my own personal development. The mentor itself is important, but more or less it's the personal consciousness that you bring in. Are you able to listen, and are you able to question yourself? Or are you full with truth and also take on the truth of other people easily? Then it's really becoming just another in-the-box solution. That is very much the experience that we made in the past, or I made in the past.
Yeah, you bring up a really good point here. You're talking about a self-organizing organization where the others may have a little bit more structure in their particular social projects. What I wonder with your project, Philippe, and I too actually have some personal experience with functioning within learning communities, but what I wonder from you and your experience is, how does one build, create, and maintain a strong sense of community within a self-organized kind of unit?
It's all about time. It's about time and energy if people and openness to connect quite right away. The sense of community is not always there, And you have to trust that this is also right and this is also true, and it's just it's the process, and you are in the process, and we all on our journey, on our life journey, we are alone. We come here, we are born alone, we will die alone, and this is also the unity that we see can be part of the illusion that we are also creating. We need people around us, and people around us are our means to evolve personally. And without community, we will also like not go into this evolution or in this development, personal development. It's not the sense of the community that is very often the trigger or holding a self-organized organization together. It's very much division, very often division. If people can follow the vision also with and without people around them.
Yeah, I would like to share a little bit, because you said that we have more structure. We have a lot more structure, but as well, we are completely self-organized, complete self-organized system. There's no boss, there's no hierarchies, because we believe that if you have somebody that's above another one, it's always it's disempowering for the people that are above. And even in the end, it's disempowering for the people above, because they cannot see everything on the ground. And they just get fed by meetings or by reports. So we have set up our academy in a way that is completely non-hierarchical. And we do this through, like, we call them learning groups, whereby different teams organize themselves, and they have the autonomy to make any kind of decisions in the end, where they are the experts in. And if they want to make decisions that combine different groups, they need to meet. We also have a hub where all the groups come together if it concerns everybody. And we found this is a really, really good tool for empowerment, because everybody can take up tasks and everybody can feel responsible. In the end, everybody is as well accountable, but that helps them to really take up leadership and not feel stuck in a structure where they think they cannot do something, because in the end, it just takes motivation and the rest will follow. If you want to do something about a task or challenge, you'll find a way, and you can consult others or get advice from others, and people can take up any task. So it's working really, really greatly for us, this process of learning groups or self-organized system. And I think it's a model that needs to be expanding much further, because even some big companies are doing it as well, the self-organized systems, but it is something that I think needs to come in more to education and schools, because that's what empowers people. They need to take up leadership, they need to take up responsibilities and be also accountable for them, because everybody makes mistakes and we learn from them. So I think we need to spread this much further, the self-organization.
For Exosphere, we talk a lot about the idea of community, and you know, at least in the United States, the word community to us means maybe just a group of people coming together. Maybe they have a similar idea or interest, and we use the word a little bit differently, because one of the things we do every week during our boot camps is this process called community building, and it's for the participants of the program, and we also do it sometimes with the team of Exosphere, but. What we do is it's modeled after an idea by Scott Peck. He was an American psychiatrist and author. One of his famous books was called The Road Less Traveled. It was really popular in the 70s. And the idea is basically we take a few hours each week, and everyone that is attending the program, we sit in a big circle, and everyone faces each other, just sits in a big circle. And really the only rules are, you know, you speak when you're moved to speak, so there's no pressure on anyone. We just sit there and people have a chance to like speak their mind. There's no expectations, there's no judgment. It's just a time where everyone's in the same room together. We can have a chance to, you know, speak what's bothering us, maybe something that's good is happening. A lot of the time people that come to the program, you know, they have a lot of things going on at home. Maybe, you know, different things happening with their family, with friends. A lot of times different things happen, and this time, for these people, it's usually one of the biggest things they take away from the program, because it's very human and it's very real. Because, like I said, because it's a chance for people to kind of take off their masks, especially in the beginning of the program. You have 30 people from all around the world, different backgrounds, different ages, different ideas about everything. You come together, and during the first couple of days, naturally, just as humans are, we kind of put on this armor. And we kind of say, okay, this is who I am. I'm Luke Blackburn. This is who I am. But really, you know, we want to get deeper. We want to see, okay, who is this person really? And these community sessions are a chance for people to lower their barriers, their walls, and really speak honestly and truthfully about human feelings, ideas, anything that's on their mind. And that is one of, like, when we had it at my boot camp, you know, it was really a fantastic experience. And since then, we've only gotten kind of like deeper and understand this whole process a little bit more. But really, it's such a human connection that I couldn't even imagine Exosphere without that. And that's probably the biggest thing that makes Exosphere unique to other programs. Because other programs that talk about like entrepreneurship and business, a lot of the stuff you could probably find online. You know, you could do online seminars, different things like that. But having that human connection with people from all around the world and really having that time to be truthful and honest is really what's like very unique. And that brings people together so much more. And that basically creates allies and other people in the community, like in the same program, they become like cheerleaders for each other. Like people are really invested in their success. And having that is really kind of like the magic, I guess I would say, of Exosphere.
Look, what you're saying, I like it very much. That I think this physical space is immensely important, also to be seen and also to see other people and to feel them. So what you're saying, like especially about like without expectations, without judgment, this creates this connectedness. And I think this is all what we are looking for our whole life since we are born. And I think this is I believe for sure an essential part what I hear out from your project. In our case, it's sometimes differently because we are sitting far, far away. So we are using, we are working with people in Kenya. We are working with people in South America at the same time in Europe. And there, very often, we need to have the trust that they just come up with their own thing and it might be totally different than we expected. But this is something which is an important learning, because we see that everybody brings in his source, his solution, and his way of how they are dealing with. This also means that sometimes there's a lot of energy there, especially if there's the opportunity of local meetings, and sometimes there is no energy there because people are getting away from the core, from this sense. So I think this connectedness, this physical connection is very, very important. And also, if we talk about self-organization, we should be very clear what means self-organization. Right now, very often people and organizations who are in a self-organized way, this is a facilitated way, not a distributed way. That means that very often we facilitate a self-organization process, but in the same way, it's like not a real self-organized process, which the facilitation leads to self-organization. And this is where we said in the beginning, okay, we do it right away. We know we want to find out what does it mean to really like to follow up like a year, 2 years, 3 years later without really having the opportunity to have this kind of physical connection and see what and there are wonders coming out. There are sometimes really like results coming out that we could not expect from the beginning, but just because of this trust, okay, we are going in this direction. We don't know. Some people might leave earlier. Some people jump in later. Some people might make a break. And this is like where we don't even facilitate this process, the self-organized process.
Well, I think you hit a great point, is that, you know, there's no one panacea or one, there's not one overall solution to this education problem that we have in the world. We need places for people to gather together. We need, you know, ways for people to stay in their current home and connect online. And that's one of the great things about technology is, you know, people can meet. And this, I almost feel like I'm sitting in the same room as you guys, but we're, you know, thousands of kilometers cumulatively away from each other. But, you know, one of the things about the meeting part is, and the community sessions in particular that I was talking about, it's really hard work, because sometimes there's moments where no one speaks for 20 minutes. And really the really interesting part is that this time is totally away from cell phones. You can't have your computers out, nothing like this. So you're forced to sit there in silence, and you're forced to ask yourself the questions that other people are raising. And it really kind of like, you can start to like really chink away and like start to unbury some really deep emotions and ideas that you didn't even know that you had. And sitting there in silence, it gives your mind and your heart time to say, okay, this person just said something very deep about maybe their relationship to their mother or father. Wow, like what are the things that I've been putting off? Like, what are the things that I haven't been asking myself about my relationship? And that is really the key to kind of like let people almost heal themselves. And it's really a beautiful process. And some people have had huge, huge breakthroughs during these community sessions. But like I said, it's really, really hard work, but the rewards of it are just really fantastic.
What you're saying is like, I think this is very, very important. We can use technology very easily. Like now we feel connected in here. We can use it very easily to increase the impact that we are going to create around us. At the same time, I also believe that just the local impact, and this is in your local community, is what really makes sense, or which is really like has the strongest impact itself. The internet, the connection like that we have right now is easy to share visions, to create ideas, to play with some thoughts. But in order to really to get work done is what Etienne is doing. He is like really there with his community there, like really every day, like setting up, okay, what is our vision? What are you going for? And this is what where the impact is from. This is learned. This is what we learned very much at the education hackathons. We said, okay, we want to be connected globally with the internet, but only if we have local communities around us. So we are doing 24 hours, we gather people together, and what we realize there is like the education issues is all around the world, it's the same. We are coming out from a hierarchical system. We want to really like to be prepared for our life, but in the traditional way of how we are doing it, it's very tough, it's very hard, and it's really depending on many, many factors, which we might not be able to really like to influence. So the community is, for me, the key to really to create the impact. This is where really like results are made.
Yeah, like what you have said, both of you, like how technology is bringing us closer and it's helping us to innovative ways of how to learn and how to get information and how to apply information, but also how important the silence is. And I had recently like a story that I want to share. Like, we have, for our students, we have computers and we have internet and Wi-Fi, and they work on them and they can do the research and they can work on the projects through those resources. But Uganda is not so stable in its electricity supply, so once in a while power cuts off for a few days. And recently, last week, we had like a power cut for 6 days, which was the longest we had so far. And then after 2 days, people got really bored, like, we cannot work on our projects anymore, what can we do now? But then after like 5 days, in the 5th day, it started to really be really, really nice and beautiful, because then people got connected much deeper and they started thinking about more collaborating and of new ways of coming together. And somehow things got done that wouldn't have gotten done with electricity or with power, because you get so distracted or you have so many opportunities that you forget about small, simple things that sometimes need to get done or just to reflect about what you're doing. So I don't know what to do with that yet, but I think it's something that we must consider sometimes, to just maybe shut down for a while and see and evaluate what are we doing and reconnect to everybody, because there's really positive things that can come out of that process.
I can share a personal story. I just came back from 3 months without computers. I went on holidays, and the first day my computer was stolen, my notebook and everything, and I was so happy and I felt so free, because after you know, so much time we spend, every day we are used to jump on the computer, check the emails, look what the friends are doing on Facebook and so on and so on, and we lose ourselves so very much in this world. And it's very powerful. Technology is very needed. We would not be able to speak now, as Luke also said before. At the same time, if we're not connected with our own purpose, with our own self, and not the people around us, it's just a pain in the ass. Sorry to say that, but it's really like, you know, it's more destructive than it's really constructive in a way that we could use it.
Yeah, interesting considerations for sure. And I personally always look forward to going into retreats, to be away from our computers as well. But you're right, it's such a balance. I love where this conversation has gone and where it's going. So we're going to go ahead and take a little break, and we'll be back right after this.
So ladies and gentlemen, at TED, we talk a lot about leadership and how to make a movement. So let's watch a movement happen, start to finish, in under 3 minutes and dissect some lessons from it. First, of course you know, a leader needs the guts to stand out and be ridiculed. But what he's doing is so easy to follow. So here's his first follower with a crucial role. He's going to show everyone else how to follow. Now notice that the leader embraces him as an equal. So now it's not about the leader anymore, it's about them, plural. Now there he is calling to his friends. Now if you notice that the first follower is actually an underestimated form of leadership in itself. It takes guts to stand out like that. The first follower is what transforms a lone nut into a leader. And here comes a second follower. Now it's not a lone nut, it's not two nuts. Three is a crowd, and the crowd is news. So a movement must be public. It's important to show not just the leader, but the followers, because you find that new followers emulate the followers, not the leader. Now here come two more people, and immediately after, three more people. Now we've got momentum. This is the tipping point. Now we've got a movement. So notice that as more people join in, it's less risky. So those that were sitting on the fence before now have no reason not to. They won't stand out. They won't be ridiculed, but they will be part of the in crowd if they hurry. So over the next minute, you'll see all of the those that prefer to stick with the crowd, because eventually they would be ridiculed for not joining in. And that's how you make a movement. But let's recap some lessons from this. So first, if you are the type, like the shirtless dancing guy, that is standing alone, remember the importance of nurturing your first few followers as equals. So it's clearly about the movement, not you. Okay, but we might have missed the real lesson here. The biggest lesson, if you noticed, did you catch it? Is that leadership is over-glorified. That yes, it was the shirtless guy was first, and he'll get all the credit. But it was really the first follower that transformed the lone nut into a leader. So as we're told that we should all be leaders, that would be really ineffective. If you really care about starting a movement, have the courage to follow and show others how to follow. And when you find a lone nut doing something great, have the guts to be the first one to stand up and join in. And what a perfect place to do that, TED. Thanks.
We're back from break, and we hope you enjoyed that video. And I just wanted to jump over to Philippe real fast. Philippe had some really incredible observations he wanted to share in regards to not only this panel, but people that are working to really make change. And let's just put, I'm going to hand the floor over to you, Philippe. It's yours.
Well, what I realized, what I could observe, like this panel consists of white male people from upper class, like privileged class. And I'm really asking myself, and this is like what I see in many places that we are working where we are really like going to rural areas, that a lot of people feel the need now to jump out, and it might be out of guilt, I don't know. Personal guilt, it might be out of really like need of change things and so on. And what I really would like to, and I'm asking myself that very much right now, how can we really create this togetherness, the connectedness with people who don't have the same chance, without creating this hierarchy and without creating kind of a situation where one feels like the victim and or like, you know, the person who is responsible for this situation. What we feel right now, because in Europe, in United States, the way we created the, or we set up the economy as such, was putting a lot of people down. Now at the same time, we now come with sometimes with this arrogance. Now, you know, we are better educated, not really like out of I don't say, maybe arrogance is now a little bit too proactive. But this also creates the separation and is not able to deal with the real fact that people, that we all have talents, that we all should see ourselves equal, but at the same time, we have different roles to play, or not roles, different responsibilities to take care of, or to take care of. And I also, what I said in the break was, I really admire Etienne, how is he doing, and I feel a different energy there. It's very much also like we come now, we first created the economy with a very male energy, like get things done, let's do it. Now we come with the same energy to change it. Let's, you know, again, we are now social entrepreneurs and we get things done now for the good, but with the same paradigm. Also startups, I see it very, very much the same. I mix it now a little bit, but also like I see that this class or this exactly who we are kind of really putting an emphasis on what's cool in the world, or what where the impact is going, where the energy is around. So just this is what was my observation. Like, how do you feel about it now? How do you think it's going next?
Yeah, I completely agree with you. It's a good observation, and I wish there was like a woman in this panel as well, and as well maybe somebody that is not like white and from the upper class. But I think a lot depends is very much on your own perception and on your own being. Like how do you act yourself, and how do you react yourself when you're in a setting like this? I believe it doesn't matter if an European goes to South America, if a European goes to Africa, if an African goes to Asia, if an Asian goes to America, whatever. I think everybody has its place when they have something to share with others and when they have something to learn from others. And it should always be a two-way process. Like, I don't have the solution for somebody else, and somebody else doesn't have the solution for me, but we can just come together and learn from each other. And that's something that we're trying to do, especially here. Like I said, I think the solution, one of the solutions might be more self-organized structures, because then you don't have any leader that takes over others, or that has the right to say that this is right and this is wrong, but people organize themselves. And for us, that has really empowered greatly our scholars and our facilitators. We went away from a system of teachers and students, but we call them scholars and facilitators, because it emphasizes more the different roles and also the way how people are equal and how they can treat each other as equal. And our bigger vision is as well that we have started now our like pilot academy, our first place, and we don't want to stop there. We want to take this idea or this model or this learning space that we created to many different places around East Africa, around the world. And it would be very, very beautiful if, for example, then we could take Africans and Ugandans to go to Chile or to Austria to take their learnings, what they have learned here, and try to implement it there, adopt it, and make it their own in Austria. And like that, opportunities are already coming up. We were in contact with people in Nepal after the earthquake. They're interested in one of our technologies that we have taken on from somebody else, and we have developed further, which is constructing using plastic bottles, a way of upcycling, whereby you use materials to create something of higher value. And we are constructing together with our students and our facilitators, also in a way together where there's no difference in the girls and the boys. Everybody does things together for the construction of our learning environment. And this is something that Nepalese people were interested in, because it's also more earthquake resistant, because the bottles, they don't break in the walls, because they're out of plastic and they can shake without breaking. So it's not yet confirmed completely, but it will be very, very beautiful if then we send a team of our people from Uganda to Nepal to share with them this technology and take away technologies and knowledge from Nepal and bring it back to Uganda. And that, I think, the way forward. It just needs to come together and on the same level without hierarchies, and just share.
My perspective on this is, I come from the finance world. I haven't been able to shake all of the methodologies, because like the way I see it, money flows to where it's treated best. And you know, I think people should do the same. People should go to places of the world where their individual skills, personalities, ideas are, you know, appreciated the most. And for me, if I'm in the United States, you know, I'm kind of just another person with a bachelor's degree that has 5 years of experience in business, so forth. Sure, my personality is unique, but I kind of saw it as, you know, going to a different place, and because for whatever reason, there's still like a stigma in some parts of the world that say, oh, the American's a smart business guy. And I think that you should be able to use that for good. I mean, if people are going to give you that privilege and that acknowledgement, then I want to use that to be able to go in and influence people to do the right thing, you know, bring my ideas to them. Now, all of us in this panel probably know, I'm sure we all know people that are not, you know, white, males, middle class, that are much more successful and smart than any of us. So I think the fact that us three are here, it's just kind of the way it fell, like the way the puzzle piece fell. But I really think that, you know, just bringing more tools to people and having the technological advancement, like people creating initiatives where, you know, they're giving away small microcomputers to people in Africa or other, you know, developing countries so they can learn how to program. Simple little things like that. More and more, we're going to give people a chance to become more, you know, well-versed in technology, more well-versed in education and everything. And the other thing is we have to start treating people as equals. I mean, sure, my education is going to be different from a young child in Uganda, but the point is giving him the tools and empowering him and making him feel like he can learn the same things as long as he has access to the internet and a computer, there's no reason why he couldn't. And, you know, I think that it's just all about continually developing these tools, bringing them to people and giving people access to really just a computer and an internet. And, you know, they're going to be okay if they want to learn. And those self-organized groups that Etienne talked about, it's very important. Just giving people a place to come together, share ideas, share tools. I think that's probably the biggest key.
Now, this is really interesting because this conversation just flowed into an area that I really want to dig a little bit deeper. Each of you come from different backgrounds and you're working on different projects. But what we're really talking about is education here. And the old paradigm of education is where you have a teacher who dispenses knowledge to students who then take it in and get tested that they've learned what the teacher had just given to the student. I don't think that paradigm of education, I think that's changing. And I think it has clearly changed among each of the panelists here in regards to the projects that you're personally working on. I was wondering if we could back up a little bit and really just define what education looks like within your worlds. And why don't we just start with you, Luke, since you brought that up.
Well, I mean, education to me is, Elon Musk has been in the news recently about how he is building a school inside SpaceX for the employees and also for his children. And, you know, one of the things that Exosphere is always, one of the main principles of education that it's been built on is the fact that you shouldn't really start necessarily with understanding electricity. You learn all of electricity, then you go to mathematics, you learn all of mathematics. You should really focus on the analogy that Elon Musk uses, how to build a motor. You say, okay, firstly, you need screws to unscrew the bolts. This is how a screwdriver works. Then you move to the next part. This is how it gets energy. And then you learn about energy. It's kind of like being more compartmentalized in terms of bringing all the tools together and starting with how the tools work instead of just, you know, the overall individual energy, then physics, then this and that. And I think we have to go to more of a personalized approach. Like you said, people sitting in a classroom, 30 to 40 kids with one teacher, it's just that was what the technology allowed for when this was first created back in the early 1900s. Now, with the power of technology, it doesn't have to be like that. But so many people are still clinging to that hope because that's traditional. That is what people understand. But, you know, there already is a paradigm shift happening. And people are seeing this. People with homeschooling kids, people with, you know, these different ideas, all the projects that we're working on, they're all a little bit different in the way they educate. But at the same time, it's always about I think it should always be more hands-on and more personalized, and instead of just the top-down approach.
Yeah, for me, and also the vision that we have with Sina is that education should be something, or that we're trying to live as well here in our place, is something that tries to connect your vision, your personal vision and your personal passions and dreams to something that you can actually live from, like you can make a living from. So we want to develop how students can make a living from what they're dreaming of. And it's possible. And I think that should be the goal of education, not to bring us knowledge that we don't even need, but to focus on the stuff that brings us closer to realize our dreams and whatever they might be. Of course, there's specific knowledge that you need to know, but I think there's many different ways how you can acquire that. And I think the old model of the teacher preaching to the students is completely outdated now. And it should be more about personalized coaching and mentoring, I think, are key as well, to bring out the best of somebody that has the drive to achieve something, and then they'll find their way.
Well, for me, education is much more than just talking about learning or learning process and what we need to evolve in. It's also about very much going outside of the places that we are looking at. It's about how do we learn to adjust as a society to the world, which is changing tremendously. It's about to learn how do we deal with food. It's about how do we deal with garbage, trash. How can we reuse stuff? How can we set up a sustainable living? This is very much education. It's about how can we show people in agriculture to use stuff which is not harming the planet that we are living in. So for me, this is all including education. It's not about mathematics. It's not about physics. It's not about like lesson subjects or even methodologies. I mean, there are many methodologies. We are all different, as everybody said. Individualized learning is part of that. But as a society, as a community, that we are now really facing issues that are really huge. The largest economy in South America, Sao Paulo, they don't have any water anymore. You have a city with 25 million people, and they're running out of water. I mean, with the brightest people there, with the coolest startups, with the best entrepreneurs, with the best, you know, whatever, you name it. But how can we really find ways in order to go out into come out in the next step of evolution that we are ready for, each one of us? So this is how I see education and what we are looking at.
Well, in the same spirit of defining what education means to each one of the panelists, I would love to hear what your definition of entrepreneurship is and whether or not that relates to social projects or personal wealth or whatever. I would love to hear what those definitions look like from each one of you. So actually, why don't you go first, Philippe?
Well, entrepreneurship for me is is creating an existence. It's not creating a job. It's not creating a work. It's not creating something what you love to do, to use your talents. It's really like creating, use your talents, find your vision in life, and make it together with people that you love. This is very much what the entrepreneurship is about. If we reduce it just of the money-making process or the process of getting goods out, getting some products out, then there's a huge, huge thing missing. And right now, what I see very often in entrepreneurship, or what I see in startup events and such stuff, it's all based on competition. And I think if we are able to change that and entrepreneurship becomes cooperative, then we might make a huge step in our society. If the paradigms are the same, and instead of like now we don't have multinationalism anymore that are really sexy for people who are really well educated, but now it's kind of startup, it's kind of being an entrepreneur, but we're using the same paradigms, this is not enough for me yet. And I think this is really like where we look at, okay, how can we learn to be cooperative, to make real collaboration happening, and really fulfill our existence that we are living in here.
Yes, for me, I think that entrepreneurship or an entrepreneur is someone who essentially tries to solve problems with extreme resource constraint. Because, for example, there's a lot of companies that are competing with, for example, Google in the technological space, and they're trying to solve the exact same problems that Google's trying to solve, but they're working with a budget of $10,000. Google's working with $10 million on a project. And it's about resource constraint, and it's about figuring out how to take on these complex problems, asking the right questions, and using your resources in a better way than these large companies. But that's one of the reasons why these small little tech companies are more maneuverable, they're more agile, and they're solving problems because of this extreme difficulty. Because if you have skin in the game and you're saying, okay, I'm going to quit a job, I'm going to come go start a startup, and I have to solve this problem, you have an incredible reason to do it. And if you have a family, if you have kids, like, you're really going to be struggling to solve this problem. People at Google, they have a salary coming in, they get a little complacent, they're like, okay, yeah, we'll work on this today, we'll do this. But the other guy, the startup guys, are like, let's do it. And I would say the difference between a startup and a company is a startup is essentially a search for a sustainable business model. Because if you start a company, you can find a way to make money once or maybe a couple times, but so many things can happen in a market overnight where you could instantly just all of your customers either move to a different competitor offering the same service for a cheaper price, or any number of things could happen to have your whole business model just be erased. So really a startup is a continual search for new ways to make money. And I have to take a little bit of a different stance than Felipe. I think that that competition is really the only thing that's going to continue to drive like innovation. Because if competition, and I don't think Felipe is saying that there should be no competition. I totally don't think that. But I think it's really important because that's what really keeps people going, and that's what makes, you know, that's what keeps the whole machine moving.
Just to jump in, sorry. I do. I really think that there is no need for competition. The only thing is, I also believe that for centuries and all our history is very much based in history. So we might not know many differences, or we don't feel really comfortable to use these differences. And this is why I believe that I understand you. And it's also the showing of the history is showing in Europe. This is why we moved on so quickly. But if you look at tribes, indigenous tribes who really live in harmony with planet Earth, there is no competition at all. And I think this is just in our own, for our own purpose, for our own good. It's just a way to go. But this, I understand you, and I know the argument that you're bringing.
Well, I think I have a middle way. Because for me, entrepreneurship is identifying a need and then doing something to satisfy or fulfill this need. And if you think it through in this direction, then competition is good, because if it caters for the needs of more people, then anybody doing the same thing caters for more needs of those people. So competition in that way is good. But also, in another sense, competition can be very harmful. It depends how you play it out. But if, for example, in Uganda, there's many needs that are not met, and that's also why there's so much entrepreneurship going on. But I think entrepreneurship is not just about companies or about big players, but here entrepreneurship happens everywhere. In the smallest village, people tackle needs by means of also economic ways. They grow something, they sell it, or very informal things of setting up small shops and doing some things and repairing. And it's all catering for needs. And our students as well, they try to get out of the competition in another way, which is by going into more or less like new markets or things that don't exist yet. If you come up with an innovation, I think that I don't agree that competition is driving just the innovation, but I think if you want to avoid competition even, you have to be innovative. And if you come up with something different, for example, like throwing out of plastic bags and eggshells, in the beginning, you don't have much competition because you're the first one doing it, or you're doing something different that nobody else has ever done before. So it needs some time that people might come up with similar ways and you have competition. But in the beginning, if you go in this direction and you cater for a need that nobody else has ever done in this same way, then you don't have competition. And so I think, competition, I think, is a two-way thing in the end.
I agree, it is a two-way thing. For example, if we lived in a purely free market, I think competition, like extreme competition, would be great, but unfortunately we don't. One example is in the United States, the whole lobby system in the United States. Companies can basically pay lobbyists in order to go to representatives to pass laws specifically aiding their business and hurting others. I think that's totally unfair competition. Now, if we lived in a free market where everything was transparent and people could get the truth, then I think it would be a little different. Now, one other point Etienne brought up is, you know, people in Uganda, like you said, they're born entrepreneurs. And I think everyone is born an entrepreneur. Children are entrepreneurs. But I think what society does to them a lot of the time is we tell them, no, you have to shrink your view into this little box. Instead of having this big view of how the world is and how the world works, no, you have to go do this because this is what school says you have to do. And one of the things, it's like, if we just were to foster that, if we were to change our mindset and start fostering young children to think more like entrepreneurs, to say, okay, here's this big problem, whatever it is you want to solve, here's this big problem, and you only have this little bit of resources to deal with it, how do you think creatively to solve that? If that's what school was, we would be so much better off. But unfortunately, we still have that old mindset that we all have talked about, and we need to get closer to helping children realize that the way they think naturally is the way entrepreneurs think.
I totally agree with you. I especially experience it very often that street kids in Brazil are much more entrepreneurial than any manager in any kind of multinational or so on. And I see your point. What I'm saying is, like, imagine if you have competition. It's not about the free market or like, because first of all, we have a limited market. That means we have limited resources. That means also that if there's competition, there's always somebody who is losing, and there's not one person losing. They're the big winner, like Stephen Jobs, like all the you mentioned, Elon Musk. Those are like the bright stars. And imagine how many people are failing on this way, getting there. And this is what we are showing them. Our society right now is creating needs or like demands for needs that we don't have. And if this is stopping and we start working together in a way of collaboration, in a way of cooperation, and we don't lose the resources on the way, the people who are suffering, the people who are failing on the way of becoming an Elon Musk or Steve Jobs, I think this would just create a much more peaceful and harmonic way of how society could be. And we could evolve much, much better. But this is like a theory. It's like, it's not theory, but it's like really hard to put in place because we don't know anything differently, or not many people know it. There's one democracy which I think it was really like succeeding in history. They came out from Africa, where one tribe making a circle, then a bigger circle was built, and a bigger circle was built, and a bigger circle was built. And each one of them, they really took on the responsibility of being there in the democracy. So far as we know it, we go there, vote, and this is the way how we think that democracy is being done. And this is what I see, you know, just because we know it that way, we have been raised that way, we have been seeing it in our history, especially in the history that we are coming out of the Western society, it doesn't mean this is the end. And if we really like are that clever, that smart as a human species, and are on the next step of the collective evolution that everybody is talking about, then I think this could also be like really a mean that we are going for, looking at, okay, how can we really like create this environment where competition is not needed anymore? Like, just one more quote. I don't know who said it. I think it was Mahatma Gandhi who said, there is enough for everybody's needs, but there's not enough for everybody's ambitions. And we have very high ambitions, and everybody wants to be the best, the fastest, the quickest, the strongest, but we can't be like there's just only one who is the fastest. Right now it's Usain Bolt. And so many people on in the competition are failing and are set or are bringing in the energy of losing. And I think this is what we should get rid of in our society.
What I think is really fascinating about this whole conversation is everybody's coming at it from different places on the spectrum. But what I'm looking at from Luke's perspective, you're internally using a collaborative paradigm to build the education, but yet you're going into an old paradigm which is competition-based. And I'm wondering if through not engineering, but seeding your teams through this spirit of collaboration, if that indeed can penetrate an old paradigm, an old system, and start changing from the inside. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think it, like, as we see, like, in the current world, this whole sharing economy is becoming very big. You know, you have companies like Uber, Airbnb. They're huge, huge companies, and it's all about sharing. It's about, you know, taking existing resources, a car or an apartment that's not being used, and you sell it to someone for a certain time, and then you get paid for it. I think, just talking about the competition part, it's, to me, if you took away competition, I think you take away just the drive that so many people have. Do you think, for example, any of the great innovators of the world, if there wasn't competition, if they just agreed with the other guys of the world that said, okay, we're going to all, you know, do X, but we're all going to get paid the same, do you think that they would continue to have worked as hard as they did? I don't know. I mean, I don't know what's inside their mind, but I know what I would do. And I think that if I had that same deal, I don't think I would work as hard. That's just my own personal opinion. But in terms of like what Exosphere does, it's always about bringing people together first, creating a strong foundation. It's about unlearning certain things that we've learned in, you know, school or the tech tabloids where it says, oh, you can, Mark Zuckerberg wears the same color shirt to make less decisions. You know, all of these weird things that they tell us what entrepreneurship is. Entrepreneurship is about understanding people and how to manage resources. Because usually the problems that we have are not really engineering or technical problems. It's simply people problems. And one of the most important parts about becoming a startup person or becoming an entrepreneur is building the right team and understanding the individual personalities and like the philosophies of each team member. I can't tell you how many really good startup ideas that I've seen die just because people can't manage, like, not even manage, but they can't even get along or solve simple problems with their co-founder just because there's pride issues or ego or different things like that. And you know, it's so important to understand simple differences in personality. For one, the biggest one is extrovert versus introvert. You know, a lot of people think an extrovert or an introvert is a shy person versus an outgoing person. It's really not. It's more about how someone gets their energy. Extroverts get their energy being around people, sharing ideas that way. Introverts get their energy from being alone, thinking, processing information. And if you just understand that very basic part, you understand why some people act so much different from others. And it really reduces the amount of friction points that could possibly arise in a team. So like I said, Exosphere is about building the right foundation, helping people grow whatever business or idea they're trying to solve or problem they're trying to solve. But then after that, it is very much about trying to help them become the best. Because, you know, it's just a philosophy that we have. I mean, the founders of Exosphere, they're more of a libertarian mentality where competition is encouraged, you know, because it's just the way that we see the world working. And there's the cool thing about Exosphere, though, it's a way for us to test these new ideas and these new, you know, programs. And for example, we're doing a space and technology program starting tomorrow on Monday in Budapest, Hungary. The idea is to, in 3 weeks, build a space model, an economics model and an engineering model to build a space elevator. Now, In that, there is no competition because it's a whole team coming together and they want to solve one big problem. And they're not going to solve it in 3 weeks. I mean, it's just, it's a way of getting people together and creating a dialogue and a context around a very specific idea. So I think I'm kind of also where Etienne is, where it's a middle ground. Sometimes there's really big need for competition, but sometimes it's about sharing and building for the overall social good of the world.
Yeah, picking up on that, I think it's a lot about purpose or meaningfulness or the cause. If you're doing something that you love and see it's meaningful to others as well, then for one, there's no competition because you want others to do the same because you want the problem to be solved. So if they do the same as you, you're just together, and then there's no competition. You can just collaborate, basically. And you see that a lot, that if there's a big cause, then people give away their things as Creative Commons or they don't mind if other people use the same model. Actually, they're happy if other people adopt what they're adopting because it has worked for them, and they would be happy if others can solve the same or similar challenge with the things that they have developed. And another point, I think, with the competition is as well, what we see here in our academy is if it's self-organized and people see the cause and they're doing something not just for themselves, but for us as well here, especially for the students, to empower them that they can reach their goals, then it's a lot about intrinsic motivation, about doing what you love to do, and then it doesn't matter. There's no incentive that needs to drive you, but you do it because you love to do it. And then you said about friction points, and you said competition can drive people, but I think if there's no competition, but you do what you love to do, then we see that some of our facilitators, they can get up in the middle of the night if they have something to do, and they don't mind, or they can work the whole weekend because not because they're getting paid or they're getting some bonus or they're getting something extra, but just because they believe in the cause. And many people, like myself as well, I don't see anything that I'm doing. I don't relate it as work. I don't see it as work. I see it as my life. I see it as something that I love to do. And then it doesn't matter if I get paid or not for it, as long as I can survive. I love what I do. And many facilitators have adopted a similar mindset of you need the basics covered, but after that, you do what you love to do, and if it fulfills you, then there don't need to be a competition, and things work out well.
I totally agree with you and what we're saying. I think if you found your place and you really like your purpose or your what you're here for, then there's no competition. You want the other one to succeed, because then you know you don't have to do that what he can do, and you really can just rely on that. And this is something really very, very, very powerful. At the same time, I really hope that more and more people are working less in the future. Sometimes unemployment is not a bad thing. It's good because people get out of the system. If they have the means, if they have the community which really can hold them and not let them fall down and saying, oh, you don't work and this is really bad and so on. Those are really main principles, old paradigms, which are really holding our society back right now. And if you bring up Uber and like where you have now this kind of sharing economy, we have to be very careful about the sharing economy, because the sharing economy uses the same principles than the old economy, just with the title of this is shared now. Now we can all use it with the technology and so on. But in the end, the shareholders of Uber, they're the ones who are getting rich and richer and richer. And it's not about the people are real, like, if we use Facebook, we're making some people around Zuckerberg rich. That's just fact. Of course, we have some things for free. But in the end, this is what I don't believe in the sharing economy as such. And I also agree with you guys if you're saying, okay, it's both ways. Why? It's a process. We're coming out from a place which is purely built on competition. Now more and more people feel, oh, well, this is not the energy that I want to carry around. Let's go somewhere where it's more cooperation. And of course we as humans, it's very hard to change from one side to the other side. But it's possible that he can survive without water and food for 7 days or longer, if we have the right consciousness for that. There are people who are making processes about that. In the medicine, if you listen about the theory, what people are told in university and students, after 3 days you're not drinking, you're not eating, you're dead. Don't tell that anybody in Africa, because people are dying there of hunger, and they're really, if there is not the same setting where this is possible, not the same consciousness where it's possible. So it's all a process. But I still believe, in my deepest inner deepest, we don't need competition.
One of the ideas that we're really focusing on recently is called the digital middle class. It's a term that was coined, I think, by Jared Lanier in one of his books. And one of the real principle of it is, on conservative estimates, in about 2 years or two decades, 20 years from now, about 47% of all U.S. jobs will be automated. So really, there's this huge push for us as a society and entrepreneurs to figure out ways where we can make this digital middle class grow. Because right now, you have these things called siren servers, where people like Amazon, Facebook, Google, they own pretty much all of the internet in terms of the real estate space of the internet. And what they're doing is they're taking, you know, content, they're taking things that people like you and I create online, and they're using that to sell and to make money. What we need to do is we need to figure out ways for people to actually monetize the things that they're doing online and create a way for people that their jobs, the people whose jobs are going to be automated, we need to figure out ways to help them be able to create a living doing things online, because really that's where everything's shifting. Now, I totally agree with you, Philippe, that we have to also get away, and we have to kind of have this big balance, because we don't want to live, well, some people do want to live online. Some people want to upload their brain into the cloud. I don't know about that. I don't think I want to do that, but some people do. But there has to be this sort of balance. But I think the market is kind of driving us towards automation, technology, more of this stuff into our lives. So this digital middle class, I view Uber and Airbnb as the first step to create this bigger, larger digital middle class, where people can figure out ways to create an additional income or even a main income through doing this. And it's definitely not perfect yet. It's all the trial and error, but you know, I think these are the first steps of where we need to go.
Wow, this is a really fascinating conversation. I want to actually ask you guys something, and this is going to be pretty highly conceptual. You're all, like I said, in different places on the spectrum in terms of the way you see you're contributing to the current paradigm and the places that you wish that the paradigm moves to. I would love for each person on this panel to define the biggest social change you'd like to see in the future, and how it is that you're working towards that individually.
Let's see. I think the biggest social change that I would like to see is just more people going after their own heart, like the things that they really want to go after. Quit living someone else's life, quit living someone else's dream, accept your own life, accept your own individuality. And the way we're doing that is at Exosphere, we're trying to create a new institution. The old institutions of the world, either universities, you know, the church, you know, whatever large old institution that used to help foster people's growth, we don't think that's happening anymore. We don't think they meet people where they are in life. And we want to create a new one, because we want to help people continually, like I said earlier, continually ask questions and re-examine their own lives and figure out, like, live a life of constant reflection. Because like I said, with each new year, with each new bit of information, the answers to those questions are always going to change. But so many of us just go through life just living, and we're assuming that we're doing the right thing, but we're not asking ourselves, we're not reflecting enough. And we need more people to understand that it's okay to ask questions. It's okay to be different. I mean, I want everyone to be different. I don't want to see everyone try to be the next whatever it may be. We just need more people following their own star. We need more people understanding it's okay to ask questions, to think differently. And you know, that's one of the main things that we want to do at Exosphere.
Well, I guess I'm taking you next. I like very much what you're saying, Luke. I think very much the same, that people really should become more professional hippies, more game breakers that we really like, or rule breakers, and we are really letting go fear, letting go expectations of what we should be, or expectations of others, what they think what we should be, and that we really live up to our inner core, what we are bringing in on this moment in this earth. We need professional hippies, people who are really like making things based on love and community, but at the same time not being caught up just by, yeah, everything is fine, everything is beautiful and a hippie. No, it's really like being professional in the way that we are also like reliable on what we are doing. Game breakers or rule breakers, we need to understand that we created a system over the last years that we need to change patterns, and we need to break out again, and we should be very consciously also breaking the rules that we build up. I mean, it doesn't make any, some laws that just doesn't make any sense anymore. Our time is changing so much, our society is changing so much. Schools in the near future will change tremendously. If there will disappear many schools, most of the schools will disappear. So we should be very conscious about this and really make the step towards that, not have the fear of, oh no, I can't do that. I think we should be really very courageous in that and very careful. We should be aware of the consequences. But now we're living in a time of transition. If we always stand on one side and not are able to go on the other side of the river, we will see it, but we will not be able to really to move on as a society. I think this is very much important. Needed.
Yeah, so many people around the world go to work every day, and they do something that they don't like just to earn enough money to provide for themselves or for their families, or to do something actually in their free time sometimes that they love, but not for the majority of their time. So my vision of my social change that I would like to see is that people are able to do what they love and they're able to live from that. And we have to find ways of how this is possible. And we're trying one way here in the Social Innovation Academy, but I believe there's many different ways how people can make that happen, and I want to see that this happens, that nobody needs to go to work to do something they don't love, or some monotonous work of putting something together the whole day and then get right crazy just to earn enough money to get by. But I would love to see everybody doing what they love, and they can survive with it.
I love how everybody...
One thing...
Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say one small addition is, I said that, you know, people really need to have more reflection and thinking in their lives, but also life needs to be about thinking and action. So really it's they go both ways. You have to think, reflect, but also, like Felipe said, not have that fear to just take the first step, just do something, start something, whatever it is you think you may want to do, start learning about it. Start, because you're never going to do it if you don't at least take that first step. And we need more encouragement and ways for people to feel empowered and getting the tools that they need in order to feel like they can start and they have, you know, what it takes.
I love how everybody on this panel is basically saying the exact same thing, but just from their own perspectives. I mean, we're talking about personal empowerment. We're talking about having tools and means to have those, to build those teams of collaboration. We're talking about asking the right questions, and we're talking about support. And to me, that's really, really encouraging, because everyone on this panel is a social innovator, and I'm really, really honored to have spent the evening with you all. I'd like to hand over the floor to each one of you and give you the opportunity to share any closing remarks and share anything you'd like to share about the projects that you're working on. If there are websites, obviously all of your bios and links will be on the Conscious Consumer Network website, but here's the opportunity to go ahead and share anything you'd like to share in this moment. So why don't we hand the floor over to Etienne.
Yeah, thank you. It's been a great discussion with all of you, and I'm really happy to have been part of this. And I think as a closing remark, I would just encourage everybody that is watching this to do not fear being different and do something different and do something especially they love, because I believe in the end things will align to you. If you do something that you love and it has a purpose for others as well, the rest will follow by itself. And we've seen that here so many times with our students and also with our facilitators. Then some small miracles might happen, and they do happen if things align because they have purpose and you do what you love to do. So, yeah. And yeah, we have a website. It's www.socialinnovationacademy.org. And there you can see progress of our students and the latest projects that are almost ready to go out to the world as social businesses and follow up on their progress. And yeah, we would love to spread those innovations in Africa, around the world. And as I said, our vision is that we don't stop in Uganda, but that we take this idea, this model in different contexts and adopt them, and we will be able to unleash the potential of many youth and of many people from around the world.
Yes, I would also like to echo Etienne just saying thanks for having us. I would encourage everyone to realize that we are just probably the 0.0001% of available programs and resources available to people that want to learn more about entrepreneurship, they want to uncareer, they want to basically just create a new path or learn a little bit more about what else is out there in life. Exosphere, we have lots of different lengths and types of programs. We have anything from a one-day workshop up to the longest program we have right now is 8 weeks. And the website is exosphe.re. So it spells out Exosphere, but it's not .com, it's .re. And you can go there, learn a little bit about what we're doing. even if you don't think you can come to a boot camp or a workshop, there's ways for you to get involved and to join the conversation of the interesting, different things we're talking about. But the real thing is find groups of people that maybe not even like-minded, but open-minded. Really, that's the key. Find people that are into learning new things and, kind of just eager and curious, and don't be afraid to ask questions and, explore what the world has to offer.
Also, I have to say thank you very, very much. It was very pleasant, and I think I learned a lot. I'm sure I learned a lot. It was really very interesting. From our side, there are a couple of ways to get in touch and to get involved with us. Somebody who wants to know how it feels to create an immediate impact and be in and around this self-organized environment, join our conscious leadership program, Edon Tour. Another thing is we're now finishing up a documentary about the conscious change revolution that we are taking in our society and the evolution of education, what it means, how it will change the face of education. We need some financial support. If you're interested in that, this would be really, really nice. And my two cents on what I think it's like the last remarks I would like to share. Yeah, let's not be afraid of being awkward or weird or like talking about love in settings which was not used to be. We should spread out love. I love that very. I really think that very much. And we should be very humble in what we are doing, and very learning to serve not only our personal purpose, but also really like we are here for a certain purpose, and like let's serve also like the bigger vision of a peaceful society where we really like spread our love.
Thank you, everybody, and yes, I agree with Philippe. I learned so much from you guys. I mean, I'm going to leave this conversation so completely inspired. So thank you all for being a part of this amazing panel and this incredible conversation tonight. And again, I want to thank Nina for having the foresight to put together this amazing group to have this conversation always, Nina, thank you. I'm so grateful for the work that you do behind the scenes, and you are the most incredible producer ever. And thank you to the Station Conscious Consumer Network for giving us always a platform to share these ideas, conversations about education and all the different tentacles and as they touch our lives in throughout society. Thank you, Mel and Biggie, for that opportunity. And finally, wherever you are and whatever you do, continue always doing it for the love of learning.
What is Edu on Tour? Not a very long time ago, there was a group of young people who asked themselves,
what is the educational system actually all about?
We realized that it's about preparing us for our future life and work. It should give us the possibility to discover and fully unfold our own talents, passion, and personal potential.
Our environment, lifestyle, and thoughts are changing more rapidly than ever before. For these new challenges, adaptation within the framework aren't enough, but a different approach to education is needed.
And guess what? We realized that a new culture of learning, living, and working together already exists. However, the majority of the people is not aware of the already existing alternatives for our educational system.
This is why we created Edu on Tour.
We designed Edu on Tour as a journey to learning environments like innovative schools, communities, projects and actors, because those are the ones who are really contributing to the transformation of education. In return, the persons on the journey connect and promote the projects over their social networks.
The three main goals are discovering and learning, connecting and showing.
But what do those three main points mean? Discover and learn.
We spot and visit the environments and actors to learn about their ways of educating and knowledge creation.
What does connecting mean?
We also want to establish a relationship with the people we meet in order to really build up a strong physical network where the souls are actually connected. We connect the project and actors which are working towards the same goal, who do not know each other yet and may benefit from a collaboration. And in every big city we are creating an event to bring actors, educators and interested individuals of this movement together. With this, we hope to contribute to the creation of a sustainable community, dialogue and actions concerning our future education.
And what means showing?
Finally, we will show the actors and their experiences in weekly video updates, blog posts, our social media channels and on the Revo map. So, we will finish the tour with the production of a documentary film about the educational movement we have experienced here in Brazil.
Well, even though our intention is to have a sustainable impact on the educational dialogue, we very well know that it can't be created by a single tour. Therefore, we created Edu on Tour as an open concept to invite people around the world to start their own Edu on Tour.
To not only invite, but also empower and support the process of making Edu on Tours happen around the world, we decided to invent the Edu on Tour home base. To support the Edu on Tours, the home base is able to provide a social network, advice, mentorship, and challenges for the tour. The home base will help sustain the Edu on Tour network of the educational players, to support and facilitate the constant educational dialogue.
The value and impact of the education projects happening right now is already huge. But right now, we can just see the tip of the iceberg.
Let's discover together and join the voices for the education of tomorrow!
If you really had to make a difference on a large scale with minimal resources, how would you go about it? Have you ever dared to dream of doing that which seems impossible? On a planet steeped with corruption and destruction, the question beckons, how do we change it? Media has a far-reaching impact on people and has been used to manipulate humanity into our current destructive patterns. In order to affect people into moving into constructive patterns of behavior, we need to construct a new paradigm of media. Conscious Consumer Network has been created with the explicit intention of giving the amazing truth-seeking, solutions-orientated, alternative media a place to fully realize their true potential with a cutting-edge, high-tech professional media platform. In turn, some of the greatest freedom-seeking hearts and souls of our time have realized the true potential of what has been created and have come together to provide their insight and inspiration on CCN. Conscious Consumer Network has become a unique, interactive information and educational network which provides a free-to-view, live-stream, ultra-high-definition channel to the world and features 25 live shows a week and growing with the addition of multiple language broadcasts. CCN has features comparable with mainstream media, such as being able to pause and rewind broadcasts whilst being live streamed. Catch up on missed or previous broadcasts, now available from CCN High Definition Downloads. You can now purchase a high-definition download of your favorite CCN show from effiemarket.com. Support free and independent media by becoming a monthly pledger. This can be done with a monthly pledge of 10 euros, which will allow you unlimited access to CCN's high-definition downloads, which hosts a back catalogue of over 250 shows, which have been aired since the launch of CCN on the 1st of January 2015. In order to keep CCN on the air, public funding is needed. Please donate to CCN's Network Support Fund or become a monthly pledger. Help keep alternative media in the hands of the people. We thank you for supporting free and independent media.